All right, this, are you taking a Docker selfie?
Smile.
All right, everyone, last chance to do your Docker selfies for DockerCon. Ooh, okay. Y'all having a good time?
Yeah. Woo!
Having a great DockerCon? Well, it's not over yet. Woo! Welcome to Moby's Cool Hacks session.
It's a tradition here at DockerCon that we close the conference with a cool hacks session. Because our Docker community is so active and creative, we invited them to participate in a cool hacks challenge. It was incredibly hard to decide, but we finally picked three awesome projects that are really pushing the boundaries of what Docker can do. Please welcome to the stage Jack Nikoloff, who's going to show us why failure isn't always a bad thing.
Okay, my name's Jeff. So, if we can get my laptop up real quick. So, I want to talk to you guys a little bit about services. Everybody's been talking about services. Solomon talked about services in the opening keynote. I think Ben talked about it a couple times. Everybody is talking about services. I've owned a lot of services. I used to work at Amazon. I've consulted with a lot of Fortune 500s and up. I've worked with a lot of startups, and everybody's talking about services. My team at Amazon owned 300 microservices, and there was 8 of us. So one thing, there's really one thing that I've learned about microservices, especially at volume, that has resonated with me over the years, and that's that if something can fail, it will fail, and that owning my own operations, it's better if it fails regularly, right? There's nothing worse than sitting on a time bomb and getting that 3 a.m. code or call and, you know, scanning through code, trying to figure out what's wrong and seeing the damn comment, this should never happen. And then saying, well, it's happening 3 times an hour and I don't know what to do to fix it. So I'd like to help people kind of avoid that situation. And so there's a whole class of tools out there to inject failure into systems. There's a whole website called principlesofchaos.org. Netflix put out Simian Army tools that are awesome. Those tools work with control planes like AWS. And they're all designed to unrelentingly break your things, right? Most of us spend a lot of our time figuring out how to make them work in the first place, but I think really, you know, kind of coming of age as an engineer, you have to say, focus more importantly on how does this bridge gonna fall apart rather than how do I actually put the bridge together? And so I was kind of looking at the Docker space, the container space, and I noticed something really, really neat in that we have this new platform and there's a new control plane. And there's all sorts of opportunities to inject failure. As like the InfoSec sphere likes to chatter about all the time, well, people could break it this way, or they could you know, get in here and tear things down, and who knows what'll happen, right? I'm thinking like, who knows what'll happen, right? So I get kind of itchy, let's break stuff. And so I thought, if I wanted to do something like a Chaos Monkey or a Simian Army and I wanted to do it on-prem or I wanted to do it on my laptop or I wanted to do it in my cloud or anywhere that I'm running my containers, I need a new orchestration abstraction to do so. So I built one. Took about a month of Sundays, and that's what I'd like to demo today. So I'm going to talk about Project Entropy. All my details plus the link to the project are on the board. And they'll remain on the board. So my demo is really, really simple. I've got a compose file, one file. In that, I'm going to use that file to spin up a local swarm cluster using Docker and Docker. It's going to have 3 nodes, all running on my 112 RC2 Docker for Mac, right? So the demo is really, really simple. I just type compose up -d. So I've just created this swarm cluster locally. But it's kind of boring in and of itself, so I also created a couple services. One of the services is just a simple ping service, just sitting there, running, pinging my favorite ICMP echo provider, Google. So I'm going to jump over here and let's see, what should I do first? Oh, first I want to show you the node count. So Docker client info, I'm going to go up for nodes. I can see that there's three nodes. Jump back over here real quick. Demo Docker client. And I want to show you that I'm running some containers. There they are. One's pinging Google, one's pinging DigitalOcean. So now that we've got some containers running, let's actually see what they're doing. So we're going to watch Google. And surprise, surprise, it's pinging Google. And it's going pretty stable, right? Pretty solid. Exactly what I would expect if I had a stable network connection from this excellent provider. So that's kind of boring, right? Like, my network can fail. If you're, you know, at home on your cable internet connection, sometimes you're like, why can't this website pull up? And so you might get itchy and pull up Google. And if you see a little bit of variation or maybe a little bit of packet loss, you start thinking something might be iffy with my network connection. So what I want to do is demonstrate that I can inject network latency by policy using this new system into a very specific container, namely this one. So enter entropy. So entropy is an API. It's a command line client, and it's a service. The service has all of the desired state managers, and it uses a Docker endpoint, any Docker endpoint, as its system of record. So let's go ahead and check it out. It's kind of boring. Just say, hey, there's no policies in this, right? So what we want to do is we want to create what I'm calling a failure policy. I don't want to say, hey, this container, introduce failure into this container. I want to define a policy so that any containers that come up will also have that policy applied. As containers go away, whatever is created for to implement that policy goes away. So let's create one now. So I'm going to create one, and I'm going to say that I'm going to roll the dice. This is all about probabilistic failure injection, right? So I'm going to roll the dice on whether or not we're going to inject failure every 10 seconds, right? And if the dice come up failure, that failure is going to last for the next 10 seconds until we roll the dice again. So let's say 10 seconds. And I want to make sure, I want to be able to specify how likely it is for the failure to occur. In this case, I'm doing a demo. It would be nice if I knew that it was going to show up, right? So I'm going to go ahead and say there's a 50% probability. Next, I want to specify what type of failure. So in the internals, this thing delegates to a tool called traffic control, and it allows me to inject a number of different kinds of failures. I've defined very specifically latency, packet reordering when network messages get jumbled around, and who knows what that's going to cause, or network partitions or partial partitions, meaning all of a sudden this container can't talk to anything. No network traffic is happening. How does it deal with it? How does the system overall deal with it? Right? But we're pinging Google, so let's just inject some latency and see what happens. So the other thing I wanted to stress is that this is not injector specific. This is not failure code specific. Really, entropy is just an orchestration platform, right? So this is totally pluggable. You can use any image as long as that image implements a certain interface, right? It has some named failure modes. It can take probability and frequency, that sort of thing, right? So this is totally pluggable. In this case, I have one already called gremlins. And last, I can specify the criteria for this policy. Now, this is a really important part, right? Let's say that I have a multi-tenant system. I've got some services, my buddy's got some services, that team over there has got some services, all in the same space. But I don't necessarily want to inject, I don't want to impose my policies on everybody's stuff, right? I want to impose it on my own. I'm the one declaring what my interface contract is. I'm the one saying I can tolerate certain latencies, so let's make sure that I'm only hitting mine. Now, this system uses Docker labeling system, that taxonomy. So any kind of expression that you can use on like a PS filter can be used to inject failure or apply a policy. So in this case, my pinging Google service is labeled with service equals ping Google. So as soon as I hit this, it's going to go off. It's going to examine the system of record in this case. It's going to look for any containers that apply there, where this policy might be applied. It's going to then say, it's going to make a scheduling decision saying, OK, I need to create a container here. It needs to have this image. I need to make sure that that gets pulled down. I need to make sure that it's aligned with this target container. And then I need to sit back and make sure that the desired state is maintained. Right now, this is taking a little bit because it's pulling the image for the first time. But as soon as it's done, two things will happen. I'll be able to list my policies, and I'll see one. And keep your eye on the left, because you might see some latency be injected. So part of the reason that I wanted to build this was for my black belt session, where I really wanted to kind of expose people to the components of an orchestration system, how they work, why they work that way, and how they're really kind of the repeated pattern over and over and over again. And I think that this tool is simple enough that we can kind of get that piece, right? Like there really isn't too much. It's all written in Golang. It's all open source. I'd encourage everyone to go out and check it out. Man, this is taking a little bit. But I'm confident that it's working. So the other thing that I wanted to do, I originally announced that I was going to do some multi-cloud. Oh, hey, there we go. So I originally announced that I wanted to do some big multi-cloud, crazy swarm cluster, right? And I kind of thought to myself, I'd seen that a couple times. So instead, I wanted to take it back and show you how small you can get, how close you can get, right? Like here, I was trying to build an application against the Docker API. And what better way to do that than by actually developing against the live running Docker API, using Docker and Docker for that kind of stuff. So we saw we got a little bit of failure. Every 10 seconds, that lasted for 10 seconds, and it decided to inject 600 milliseconds. And then they were rolling the dice again and again and again, and they look, it happened again. So that's the real nuts and bolts. So kind of in closing, I would encourage people to think about this kind of stuff. Like, this can happen. And not only think about failure, but also think about other ways that you can build on top of these awesome APIs, these new control planes that are popping up every day. Like, think about your use cases and figure out, what can I do to actually go out and implement that? Is it really within reach? And have fun. So, thanks.
All right, that was great. Let's give one more hand for Jeff Nikoloff. Our next hack was done by Ben Firstman, who is one of the leading lights of Docker. And he has a very functional demo. Ben. Let's go. Let's go.
Thank you, Mano. Gosh, this is a lot of people. So every now and then, there's sort of a kind of a new wave of technology that turns up that sort of that promises to make the previous wave of technology redundant. And one of those things that's appeared recently is a thing called serverless. And this has been popularized by AWS's product called Lambda. The idea of serverless is that you can deploy your applications as a series of functions which are hosted in the cloud. And then they're only called when they need to be run on demand. So they essentially scale infinitely. And it's been kind of suggested that serverless is a thing that's going to make Docker redundant. But what I want to show you today is the idea that actually serverless just is Docker. And Docker is the perfect platform to be building serverless applications on top of. So as a way of demonstrating this, I can show you a bit of code. And what I'm going to do is import a Docker library, connect to a swarm that is running. And then with this client, I can call functions that are Docker, images. And the nice thing about Docker is that these functions that we're calling can be written in any language at all. So I can use any piece of functionality from another language, like this, for example. And I can pass it arguments as if I was just calling a function from my library, sorry, from the language that I'm writing in. And then I can execute this. And what this has done is this has spun up a container on a swarm using whatever free resources that are available in my infrastructure and just returned me the output as if it was a function. That's pretty cool, isn't it? But I have really just shown you a Docker run, but you know what I mean. Now, how would, like, given this technique of running functions inside, running functions as Docker containers inside applications, how might this work in an actual application? So, throughout this conference, you've seen the voting app many times. This is the architecture of the application that we've been showing. Essentially, it's five long-running services. It's two web front ends, which have two different web applications. It's a message queue, and it's a worker process, which takes work off that message queue, and then stores data in a database. So how might we convert this to a sort of serverless application? Well, a really sort of low-hanging fruit here is this message queue and worker process. So let's have a look at what we can replace that with. I've got the application up here. And what we've got is this, this bit of code here, which receives votes when you make a vote. And instead of putting that work onto a message queue, what we can actually do is just run a Docker image directly, which is being run on a swarm. So it's just running a Docker image, taking some arguments, and it's also running in the background, which is another neat thing that we can do with Docker. So once we've converted that, we've got an architecture that looks a little bit like this. What we've done is essentially converted the message queue and worker process into a single Docker image that's just run on demand. We've also got a couple of other long-running processes here, which are HTTP servers. And HTTP servers are kind of interesting because they're kind of similar to that thing we just converted in that they're sitting there waiting for HTTP requests. And when you get an HTTP request, it does a bit of work and then returns an HTTP response. So we can actually turn that into a Docker container. And now it turns out that this is actually a solved problem. And it was solved decades ago by a thing called CGI. So what we've done is this Python application that we've got, instead of serving up a HTTP server, what it's doing is we're just using a CGI handler here. And this is the CGI handler that's been built into Python for, well, decades, because this is how we used to write web applications, right? So essentially what this does is the Docker image, when this Docker image is run, it just immediately returns with an HTTP response and quits. Which is just what CGI is. So I wanted to do the same thing to the result application, but sort of unfortunately, the result application was written in Node.js. And Node.js is such a modern language that it doesn't actually have support for CGI. So what I had to do is I had to rewrite the result application in another language, which has like brilliant support for our next generation serverless CGI applications. So I rewrote it in Perl. So here we've got the same thing that the Node.js application does, but written in Perl. And all it does is serve up a web page and then queries for results from our Postgres database. So let's look at what we've got. We've now got this application where we've got a we've replaced those web servers with just Docker images that just serve up single HTTP requests. And I've written a really lightweight HTTP server as an entry point, which essentially just takes HTTP requests and then runs Docker containers and pretty much just sits there doing nothing apart from forwarding traffic. It's a bit like a load balancer, if you like. Now let's take a look at this thing running. So I have our vote application. And oh no, I forgot to run it. It's a compose application here, which we do compose up. So it boots up the database, which isn't serverless yet, and the entry point server. And let's open it up here. And this is the voting application that you've seen, like written as a serverless application. And here it is working. So you've seen a few times throughout the conference, probably, some demonstrations of load balancing by this container ID changing. And if I refresh the page here, we can see that we've gone one step further. And in fact, every time we load this page, it is spinning up a fresh Docker container to serve each page. Cool. And let's open up the result application. So result application, vote for cats. Spinning up a few Docker containers. And there we go. It's working. So that is a complete web application with a complex architecture, which we've now rewritten to use serverless, basically just using pure Docker. Now, what can we do with this? So this is kind of sort of a joke, because I'm not really suggesting that you rewrite your Node web servers as CGI Perl scripts. But what we've done here is we've actually got a whole bunch of really useful techniques that we can use to be able to build serverless applications using Docker. And firstly, the first thing that we've done is that we've packaged up bits of functionality in our Docker application inside Docker containers. And the next thing we've done is that we then run those Docker containers on a swarm. So those bits of functionality in your application basically effortlessly scale infinitely up to the size of your swarm, obviously. And then the next thing that we've done, which is really interesting, and it's sort of the recursive nature of this technique, is that the functions that you're running on Docker can then run more functions on Swarm. So you can build these sort of complex architectures using just Docker and Swarm. Now, the worker process that we had before is a really good example of how you could do this sort of thing. But you can imagine a load balancer that could run its own web front end on a Swarm. You could build an auto-scaling web load balancer that was contained inside a single container and spun up more web front ends as it needed to handle load. Or you could package up a database inside a Docker container that knew how to spin up all of its replicas and shards on top of a swarm. And there are a whole load of possibilities that you can do here. And in fact, the sort of analogy with CGI is quite interesting, because back in the 90s, CGI was this incredibly exciting piece of technology. Like, before, you could only serve static files using web servers. And CGI allowed us to produce, to generate dynamic content and basically build anything we liked. And we're at sort of a similar point with distributed apps right now, where we're still building distributed apps, as if we're assuming that servers have to live around for a long time and are slow to start up and all that sort of thing. So this example I've showed you today is kind of it is the distributed app equivalent of a crappy Perl CGI script. But there's so much more that we can do. But to be able to do that, we're going to need better build tools. We're going to need libraries. We're going to need documentation. We're going to need examples of how to do these techniques. And we can't do that alone. So we need your help. And I've created this GitHub repository here with a bunch of links off to examples of how to build applications using this technique. And if you're building stuff like this, please contribute to that repository as well. We've got an IRC channel on Freenode, and these are my details if you want to message me directly, because if you're interested in this sort of stuff, I really want to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ben. So, I don't know about you, but I really feel like DockerCon has flown by. Our next hack is taking Docker to new heights, and, well, I don't want to drone on about it anymore. Please welcome Alexandros, Petros, and Greg to the stage.
Hi, everyone. So we're going to show you, have you ever heard of an over-the-air update that they do for like phones or embedded devices? We're going to do an in-the-air update of the drone over on the other side of the stage. So at Resin, we use Docker to sort of manage updates to embedded devices, industrial internet stuff. But we thought for a cool hack session, we're going to take a drone and show you what we can do with that. So we use Docker and the core functionality there, but actually taking this core DevOps paradigm and bringing it to the embedded world, it turns out you need a bunch of other things to make the whole system work. So in this demo, you're going to see a few features that we've built. For one, the CPU that is on embedded devices is not always, actually rarely is, an x64 Intel. So what you need to do when you're building a container for those architectures is actually cross architecture, if you're doing it on an Intel server, that is. Then on the drone itself is running a minimal operating system with just enough user space to run Docker. And then, of course, all the interesting things happen inside of the container. If you see this drone right now, if you could sort of visualize the Wi-Fi right now, it is pretty saturated. So when you're doing an update to a device that is sort of embedded or over a 3G network, 2G network, we've seen sometimes, you need to be very, very careful about bandwidth. So we've built a technology we call container deltas that can push a container delta, essentially, over the air with minimal use of bandwidth. And finally, we're going to show you our embedded update strategies. So to explain what that is, when you think of a server, I don't know if you've heard of the cattle versus pets story where, you know, servers are cattle, and if you lose one, it doesn't matter. You can fire off an API request and get a new server. When your drone is flying, right, or where you've got a 3D printer or somebody's smart lock or a skyscraper, it's kind of hard to fire off an API request if you've lost, I don't know, a wind turbine in the middle of the ocean. So when you update that, you have to be careful. You have to do it in a slightly different way. So just to see what's running on the drone is a basic operating system. We call it Resin OS. It's based on Yocto and Docker. Then after that, we've got the Resin agent that manages the containers using Docker APIs. And the application itself, so what you're going to see is the application running on the drone. The update strategy that we're going to use now, this is really, really something I don't think you've seen before. So we've got version 1 running on the drone right now. And we're going to send an update. But instead of sort of tearing down version 1 and then maybe starting up version 2. We're going to actually start version 2 first, and then the containers are going to exchange resources. So the state is going to move from version 1 to version 2. When version 1 is finished passing over the state, it's going to send a message to the agent, say, kill me. Then is going to go away, and version 2 can remain and keep running the drone. The result of that is a tiny, tiny gap in service. So you're actually going to see almost no gap. We're actually going to show you, the way we've done the demo, you're actually going to see how small that gap is. I think that's it. So we can go for the demo. So here you can see the Resin IO panel. You can see the drone. You can see what commit of the container is running. You can see the logs and all those things. Now, one thing we've got in the Resin panel is a web URL. That means that the drone itself has a URL that you can reach it from the web. So here we click that, and we see a web server that's running on the drone inside the container. And that is showing us some analytics. You can see as the drone is sort of moving up and down, the gyroscope is recording data. And we're seeing that from a web server that's on the drone. So let's say we've got a lot of these drones are flying out there, and all of a sudden we realize we haven't activated a thermal camera. So we want to send an update to do that. So our developer, just on their laptop, you know, normally just goes and, you know, thermal camera equals one. Sorry, this is totally demo-ware. And makes a commit to their repository, and then adds that to Git, and Git push Resin master. Now that code is going on to the Resin servers. It's getting built. It's getting built for the right architecture. So the container that we produce here is an Intel 32. That drone is running an Intel Edison, As that container gets done, it gets reposited in our Docker repository to be downloaded by the drone. One thing about this demo is that if we do it right, you won't see very much happen, right? The whole point is that the drone will keep flying. But we've made some visual signals on the application that's hosted to show you that that's happening. So as soon as the container is done being shipped to the Docker registry, what you will see, first of all, is the unicorn, so the push was successful. And secondly, if we switch back to our panel, you can see that the device has been told that it's downloading, that it's a new container and it's downloading it. We use container deltas, so the download is actually tiny. You're going to see it go to 7% and then finish because there's just not enough time to send us a lot of updates about what it's doing. And then you're going to see two vertical lines show up on the graph. They're very, very close. The first line is when the old container gives up. And the next one is when the new container takes over. So that's how we know that the gyroscope has been passed from the old version to the new. And then you're going to see the thermal camera show up. That's it. There it is. The new version's on. And the thermal camera is activated. All right, so I think we can land the drone now safely. All right, yeah. So this is our cool hack: how you can use Docker with Resin IO on an embedded device. If you go to Raspberry Pi at home, just go to Resin IO and sign up, and you can do your own embedded projects with Docker. This was our cool hack. Thank you very much.
Pretty awesome. Let's hear it one more time for Containers in the Sky. DockerCon is a huge event. There's so much that happens here. I didn't even get to go to any of the breakout sessions. I'm sure you all got to see tons of content, but there was so much more that happened. So Around the world, Docker meetups are having Docker recap meetups. And that is, those are events where you can go, find out what you missed, and also share your experience with other people. And there's lots of ways for you to get involved with these. You can get involved as speakers, as organizers, as sponsors. And these are happening, as I said, all over the world. We've got Tokyo, Prague, London, San Francisco, and a whole bunch more. And if it's not happening in your community, you can make it happen. So this is a great way for you to get involved with the Docker community and meet more people than just the, what are we at, 4,000 people in the room? And meet many of the other people in the community who are doing similar work to you.
Speaking of participation, we are incredibly excited to announce the Docker 112 Hackathon. Yeah. Starting this Thursday, it will last for an entire month, and it will be run entirely online. We're really excited to be using an online hackathon platform called DevPost, so you can meet team members, share ideas, and submit your final hack projects. This is a perfect opportunity for you guys to apply all of the tips and tricks that you learned here over the last 2 days at DockerCon, and there are bonus points for any contributions or bug fixes.
So we'll see you online. Now, I'd like to welcome back to the stage Solomon Hikes and Ben Gallo.
Hey, everyone.
Hey.
Hello. All right. Well, it's almost over. And soon we'll be able to go and, I guess, invade Seattle. So just a few more slides.
All right. So first, of course, another big round of applause to our sponsors. Want to thank them for making all of this possible. Again, not only the conference itself, but also helping to enable scholarship programs for people to attend DockerCon. Yeah, so thank you again.
Oh. One second. All right, everyone.
Everyone,
do
like
something.
This? Okay. We should get like a thermal selfie or something like that.
Yeah,
that would be really, really cool.
Oh. There's two. Okay.
Okay.
All right. We want to bring one more guest on stage and to talk about a topic that is really, really important to us, and that's the topic of harassment, and in particular, online harassment. As you know, Docker is organized online most of the time. We spend a lot of time together on the internet, and because we can all go online and communicate and coordinate on the internet, we can build amazing things together like Docker. And it's just mind-blowingly unfair and really unacceptable that the internet is not a welcoming place for everyone. And I hope all of you agree. It really pisses me off, like in a really huge way. So just let's just make a lot of noise if you're pissed off by that, honestly. Come on.
Yeah, yeah.
Come on!
Come on!
I don't know, I don't even have the words to say how just dumb it is to do that. So we thought it would be a good idea to invite someone on stage who can talk competently about doing something about that problem, because the worst part about seeing that happen, and Ben and I have both seen that happen to several people we know, and can you raise your hands if this has happened to you or you've seen this happen to someone you know? Just raise your hands. All right, just look around. Come on.
Yeah.
This is not normal, right? So the most frustrating part is, this is my personal experience, I don't feel like we've found enough ways to do something about it. It's just too hard to catch the people who do it. It's devastating for the people who experience it, and there's not a lot of visible signs. The one thing I learned is that someone could be experiencing that right now, Think about the number of hands you saw. Maybe more people are experiencing it. Maybe someone you know right now is experiencing it and hasn't told you. That's just another really hard part about it. And there's just so many aspects that are frustrating, and including the fact that sometimes we don't know what to do. So we wanted to talk a little bit about something we can actually do. And to talk about that, I'd like you to welcome on stage Kelsey Whiterow.
For having me. Can you guys hear me okay? All right. So, like you said, it is dumb. I think that's the best way you put it. It is dumb and it is sad that this is happening. We all deserve a wonderful, awesome, inclusive experience online, and there's so much that the internet has to offer. In January, Intel, Lady Gaga's Born This Way Foundation, and Vox Media joined together to form Hack Harassment. We are taking this on, and we want you to know there is something you can do. There's something we can all do. We're going after this to raise awareness. We want you to know that you can be empowered to make a change, to make a difference. We're fostering collaboration. We've got tech, we've got nonprofit, we've got media, and we've got Docker. And together we can do something. Collaboration is going to make this happen. And beyond that, where I get to really nerd out from my Intel side is that there's technology that can help us here. So while we raise awareness and while we change behavior, we can build technical solutions to help these social media platforms and to help communities like yours prevent, detect, and help fight this cause and stop online harassment. So thank you very much for your time. I'd like you to take a moment, pull out your phone, go to hackharassment.com/pledge, and please pledge with me to fight online harassment. Thank you.
Thanks. Please do it. After this conference, just everyone just actually go ahead and do that, please. All right. nope. Oh, okay. So,
Bump Up. So as you may all recall, we had Bump Up. There were basically a program in place so that as you met, as you shared, as you learned, you could earn points. And the real point of all this was not so that you could earn points, but so that we could unlock a number of points to unlock the Docker Scholarship Program, which makes it possible for us to fund underrepresented groups in the tech community. Again, you could get points if you met somebody by bumping. You could get points as you went to hands-on labs, as you shared, as you communicated with others. Now, there are 4,100 people in this conference, which means theoretically, you should have been able to earn 16.8 million points. This is how our VCs think. But fortunately, we limited it to 2 million. Very excited about where we're at. But before we talk about where we've got to as a group, we'd like to congratulate the winners, the people who earned the most points. So with that, let's see who won.
So in the Beluga category, Arthur Keys. Arthur Keys. Oh, not
Arthur
everyone's
Keys.
Here, huh?
Stand up.
Over there. All right, stand up. Woo! Oh, we forgot to say, so go to the registration afterwards and you're going to get your gift. We don't have it here.
All right, and we're going to try and do this now in sort of the awkward award show style.
So, yes.
So, Solomon, the next category is narwhals. I don't know if you know that narwhals are a very important part of horned whales. All right, so the next person in the narwhal category is Susan Salaturo.
Susan.
Heading up, right. Okay.
And now, Orca Daniel Berg. I just want to say, we are terrible at this. We're really bad at this.
We really are. This is not a cool hack, but that's okay.
Yeah.
All right, in the humpback category, Daniel Cristianto. Please stand up.
And if this is going, the more we're going, the better it is, right? The more
the
points.
The bigger the whale, I
think. Okay, the bigger the whale. All right, so the blue whale is Cameron Bruner.
Hi,
All right, and now the moment you've all been waiting for, to see whether or not we have unlocked the 2 million community points to therefore unlock the Docker Scholarship Fund.
Now
with that, Solomon, do you want to click?
Yeah. Now's the time to bump your neighbors, just in case.
Now's the time to bump in case. And again, you can also meet, you can share, you can learn. So Solomon, can you explain Ben Fershman's demo to me just so
oh,
that
yeah.
I can learn something? All right.
All right, let's
all
see
right.
that.
Are we there?
Bump, keep bumping.
Keep bumping.
Keep bumping.
Keep bumping. Keep bumping. Right. Keep bumping.
Wait.
Keep bumping. Keep bumping. I don't know if you can meet the same person again. Yes, right. We have unlocked it. Woo! Who would have thought? Who would have thought? All right, thank you all. We've now unlocked $50,000 worth of scholarships for people in underrepresented communities. We're doing this in conjunction with Reactor Core, and again, want to thank you all. I guess it looks like we reached 2,084,575 points. So thank you all. This is fantastic. And now a few more thank yous.
A few more thank yous. So could the contributors and maintainers stand up, please, one more time? Please, a round of applause. All right. And I noticed the queue of PRs is accumulating, so we, after this, we're going to have to go back and flush the queue.
All right. Next group is Docker employees. Before all the Docker employees stand up, though, there's a special group that I want to recognize. This is our Boom team. These are the people who put on DockerCon. So if you are on the Boom team and you are still able to stand, please stand up. And I don't know, is Ashlyn here? Ashlyn coordinates all of this. Is she here?
She's sleeping.
Or she's there. Woo! And Danielle, Ashlyn and Danielle. All right.
She fell asleep.
She fell asleep, probably. I don't blame her. And if I could just ask all of the Docker employees to stand up, yeah, you're amazing, and it's such an honor to get to work with you.
I just want to say this team has worked so hard to make all of this possible for you. You have no idea. So thank you. It's an honor to work with you, really, really. All right. So we're going to see what that
we're going to see.
Looks
so
like.
So you may recall that we asked you all to take selfies and that we're going to use them to represent something really cool about DockerCon. And I think it's time for the big reveal.
Woo! Nice. So that's it. We're so happy to have had you. Thanks for coming. That's DockerCon. We'll see you next year.
All right.